On May 12, 2017, a ransomware worm called WannaCry infected over 200,000 computers in 150 countries in less than 4 hours. Hospitals went dark, train stations froze, entire organizations ground to a halt. And here's the kicker. The attack was stopped by a 22-year-old security researcher who accidentally found a kill switch while analyzing the code from his bedroom. But the real story of WannaCry isn't just about one chaotic Friday afternoon. It's about how stolen American cyber weapons, North Korean desperation, and a string of coincidences created the perfect digital storm. Let's start with what happened that morning, because when WannaCry hit, it hit hard and it hit fast. Around 7:44 a.m. in Southeast Asia, computer screens started turning red, not the friendly "please restart your computer" red. The terrifying "your files are now encrypted and you have 72 hours to pay us" red. The message was simple and brutal. Oops, your important files are encrypted. Want them back? Send $300 in Bitcoin to this address. You have 3 days. After that, the price doubles. After 7 days, your files are gone forever. Within 60 minutes, the infection jumped continents. Latin America lit up with reports of compromised systems. By 10 a.m. UTC, Europe was in full crisis mode. Spain's Telefonica telecommunications giant saw thousands of machines locked. France's Renault automobile factories shut down production lines. Germany's Deutsche Bahn railway company watched helplessly as departure boards went blank. But the worst impact was in the United Kingdom, specifically the National Health Service. We're talking about one of the world's largest healthcare systems, serving over 60 million people, suddenly crippled by malware. At first, it was just a couple of hospitals reporting IT problems, then dozens. Then at its peak, roughly one-third of the NHS infrastructure was effectively offline. Imagine you're a doctor starting your shift that Friday. You walk into the hospital, grab a coffee, head to your workstation, and boom. Every computer screen in the building is showing a ransom demand. No patient records, no imaging systems, no way to look up medication histories or allergies. Everything you've relied on for years to do your job safely just gone. That's exactly what happened to Dr. Tony Bleetman, an emergency consultant working in London that day. He arrived just before noon for his shift. The office was full of doctors and nurses, all staring at their screens in disbelief. Within minutes, phones started ringing. The same thing was happening across the country. The IT infrastructure wasn't just compromised, it was decimated. So what did they do? They went old school. Someone grabbed a whiteboard and marker pens. They drew a floor plan of the emergency department and started tracking patients manually. Paper forms came out of storage. Handwritten notes replaced digital records. It was like stepping into a time machine, except people's lives were at stake and nobody knew how long this would last. Surgeries got canceled, not because doctors didn't want to perform them, but because modern surgery relies heavily on digital support systems. Patient imaging, blood work results, monitoring equipment that feeds data into centralized systems. Without those tools, performing complex procedures becomes incredibly risky. So everything non-essential stopped. Ambulances were diverted to unaffected hospitals. Patients in smaller facilities couldn't get transferred to major trauma centers. The entire coordinated network that makes modern healthcare function just fell apart. And this wasn't just happening in the UK. Russia got hammered. Spain's infrastructure took massive hits. Computers in schools, government offices, and private companies across the globe were displaying that same red screen, all within a few hours. Now here's where it gets interesting. WannaCry wasn't actually that sophisticated. The malware itself was relatively simple. What made it devastating was how it spread. Most ransomware needs you to click on something. Open a sketchy email attachment, download a fake invoice, visit a compromised website. WannaCry didn't need any of that. It was a worm, meaning it could move from computer to computer automatically, without any human interaction. It achieved this through two incredibly powerful tools. Tools that weren't created by North Korean hackers or Russian cyber criminals or anyone in the underground hacking community. These tools came from the United States National Security Agency, and they were stolen, Let's rewind to April 2017, just weeks before WannaCry. A mysterious group calling themselves the Shadow Brokers had been posting strange messages on social media for months. The messages were written in broken English, full of weird political rants and trolling. At first, people thought they were nobodies, script kiddies looking for attention. But buried in those posts were links, and those links contained something absolutely explosive, an entire collection of cyber weapons stolen from the NSA. These weren't amateur hacking tools. This was military-grade exploit software that America's intelligence agencies had been developing for years. Among them was something called EternalBlue, an exploit that took advantage of a vulnerability in Windows operating systems. Specifically, it targeted SMBV1, a protocol that Windows computers use to communicate and share files over networks. If your computer was running an unpatched version of Windows, EternalBlue could give an attacker complete control of your machine, remotely. No password needed, no warning, just instant access. The NSA had known about this vulnerability since at least 2012. For 5 years, they kept it secret. Why? Because it was too valuable. EternalBlue gave them a skeleton key to hundreds of millions of computers worldwide. They could monitor targets, extract intelligence, and conduct operations without anyone knowing. Telling Microsoft about the flaw would mean losing that capability. But in March 2017, everything changed. Microsoft suddenly released a patch for the vulnerability. No explanation. Just a quiet security update. Most experts believe the NSA finally tipped them off after realizing their tools had been stolen. The problem was, by then it was too late. The Shadow Brokers had already dumped EternalBlue into the wild, and while Microsoft had released a patch, most people don't update their computers immediately. Some never do. Millions of machines remained vulnerable. In December 2017, the United States government publicly attributed WannaCry to North Korea. The White House held press conferences. Intelligence officials gave statements. North Korea predictably denied everything, but the evidence was overwhelming. From the code similarities to the infrastructure reused to Park Jin Hyuk's identity, it all led back to Pyongyang. Every link in that chain had to connect perfectly for WannaCry to happen the way it did. Remove any single element and the attack either doesn't happen or causes far less damage. But they all aligned. And for a few terrifying hours on a Friday in May, the world got a preview of what modern cyber warfare looks like. Not targeted attacks against military systems or government agencies. Indiscriminate infections that take down hospitals and schools and businesses. Digital weapons that don't care about borders or innocent bystanders. And Marcus Hutchins? His story took some dark turns after WannaCry. Just months after becoming a hero, he was arrested in the U.S. for completely unrelated charges involving malware he had allegedly created years earlier. He eventually pleaded guilty, received a lenient sentence due to his cooperation, and now works in cybersecurity while being vocal about his past mistakes. It's a reminder that the hacker world is complicated. And people rarely fit into simple categories of good or bad. As for WannaCry itself, variants still pop up occasionally. Organizations running old, unpatched systems remain vulnerable, but nothing has matched the scale of that initial outbreak. It was a moment when everything went wrong at once. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.